You want to invest in robotics?
Yeah.
You're going to need to know about magnetic fields.
Oh, we're getting way nerdy with this episode.
Let's talk about Allegro MicroSystems.
Yeah, it's been a year since we did a public video, but we talk about it semi-frequently over on Semi Insider. Speaking of which, you should check that out if you want access to all of our research and the new supply chain tool that we have been building over there. You want to learn about semiconductor stocks? It's what you need.
The Semiconductor Insider Research Platform is available now on our website. You can get access to that by signing up for a membership only on our website, chipstockinvestor.com. We'll see you over there.
Let's talk about the Allegro MicroSystems. Casey, tell us where they fall into the global electronics manufacturing supply chain.
Allegro MicroSystems fits into Fabless chip designer over on the right side of the semiconductor industry flow. We'll show you a little bit of history about them. They're a spin-off of Japan's Sanken Electric, and they have the Polar Semiconductor Foundry.
It's like a love
It's
triangle.
a love triangle. We'll show you that on our supply chain analysis right here.
Basically, both Polar Semiconductor, which is a private company, it's a US-based foundry, mature node manufacturing. They do a lot of power chips and sensors. Nothing super exciting, but Allegro and Polar both used to be subsidiaries of Sanken Electric. They've been spun off. Polar got some US CHIPS Act funding. Allegro also has a minority stake in Polar Semiconductor, but it's gotten smaller in the last couple of years. And Allegro now uses TSMC, of course, naturally, who isn't using TSMC these days, for a lot of its wafer fabrication. We have uploaded all of our past work onto the app under the Allegro MicroSystems company page, if you'd like to take a look at that.
We're going to touch on the downstream customers a little bit later. A lot of auto and industrial part suppliers, a lot of industry specific, which is where the robotics comes into play. So we'll talk about that in just a bit. We'll classify the semiconductor company into the auto and industrial segmentation end market. Of course, we all know it's been a while now. We've been in the doldrums, but beginning of a new growth cycle for auto and industrial and even some robotics. Since we're focusing on more of the tech. This was in Allegro MicroSystems, a slide deck for their quarterly presentation. The industry's first 10 megahertz TMR current sensor. What does that mean?
What is TMR? What does that even mean? And there's an electric car and a charger in the background. There's also some data center server racks giving a little stock photo smorgasbord going here. Let's talk about TMR. We've highlighted on the right the different types of magnetic sensor technology that exists. And basically, from left to right is like the oldest stuff all the way to the newest stuff, TMR on the right. And Allegro got into these TMR sensors mostly via acquisition. A couple of years ago, they acquired a company called Crocus Technology. And so let's break this down. What are these different magnetic sensors culminating in these TMRs? So let's start with Hall effect sensors. And for just a little bit of background here, this is where we're going to do physics 101 to take you back in time to high school, maybe undergrad studies. And the way it works is some of these semiconductor-based sensors, they're designed to interact with a magnetic field. And so, what is a magnetic field, you might ask? We're actually in the midst of a big giant one. The Earth's core creates a magnetic field. So one way a magnetic field is created is when there's a ferromagnetic material, like let's say iron or nickel. The Earth's core is made out a lot of iron. And a ferromagnetic material is when the electrons orbiting the nucleus of an atom are all spinning in the same direction. If you get enough of those spinning in the same direction, that material becomes magnetized and it creates a magnetic field. And so, like, the big magnetic field we're in is around the Earth, protects the Earth from solar flares and radiation coming from the sun, that kind of thing. Another place where you get a magnetic field is if there's electric current flowing through something, like, for example, a wire, or it could be an electric motor or something to that effect. And so these little sensors are designed to interact with and sense those magnetic fields. Let's start with the Hall effect sensor. These are the old ones that have been around for a very long time. They use the Hall effect principle. When a current carrying conductor is exposed to a perpendicular magnetic field, and then there's a voltage that's produced, and that voltage can be measured, and it is used to sense changes in that magnetic field. So it can sense the presence of the magnetic field, the polarity of it, the strength of the magnetic field. It converts it to a digital signal, and it's used elsewhere in the system to do things like control current, to sense the direction something is moving in, the position. These things have been around for a long time. They're very cheap. They're very durable. They can be used in harsh environments. So a lot of these are used in cars where they're resistant to dust, grime, and obviously because they're cheap, companies can pick them up off the shelf. If it's an entry-level car, especially lots of Hall effect sensors are used in different motor control units. But we have newer stuff, magnetoresistive or MR sensors. And we'll show you the slide that shows the progression of these here in just a moment. But there's two different types, MR and GMR. Basically, they both use a similar principle where there's alternating layers of ferromagnetic material. Again, that's just basically a magnetic material like iron or nickel or some sort of alloy. But they're layered in thin films on a semiconductor, and then they can sense the direction of a magnetic field and measure changes in resistance. So these things are used in things like switches, power switches, parts that rotate or move, cool stuff. And then finally, TMR sensors, which Allegro likes to talk about these because they're the leader in these new TMR sensors, also use these thin films of ferromagnetic material. But what they actually measure in this case is it's not exactly the magnetic field itself, but they're actually measuring the ease or the resistance in which electrons in these thin films can tunnel through a barrier when exposed to a magnetic field. And that resistance changes. It's called the tunneling magneto-resistive effect. It's a quantum mechanical phenomena. So these are very sensitive sensors. They're very resistant to outside influence. And so they're very precise, but they're also very expensive. So typical with newer semiconductor technology, it starts out very expensive. The addressable market is very small, but over time, as the cost gets driven down, adoption increases. And so that's what Allegro is trying to work on.
All of these sensors that you just discussed are something that Allegro provides to the various end markets.
Specifically TMR sensors, a lot of silicon carbide and gallium nitride based semiconductors need this type of sensor. This is one of the many reasons why a lot of parts that go into electric vehicles, let's say, for example, or high voltage applications like data centers, are so expensive right now. It's not just that it's a silicon carbide or gallium nitride semiconductor device, power device. There's other parts and pieces that go with this. One of them would be perhaps like a TMR sensor.
On the left side, we have the magnetic sensor integrated circuits. And then on the right side, the power chips, the power ICs, all of the black dots are what Allegro has. And then the black dots that are highlighted with green are the 48 volt ready. What does that mean exactly?
All sorts of applications are making the switch over to higher voltage. And so that requires really a new type of power architecture. And Allegro has products that are ready for all of that. So all sorts of different auto and industrial end markets here. With an automotive, there's the whole powertrain part of the vehicle. Advanced driver assist systems, kind of a separate application within the car as well. The safety systems. And then, of course, a lot of hybrids and internal combustion engine vehicles also adopting a lot of this technology as well. And then further down on the industrial side of things, renewable energy, renewable power, like solar, data centers, of course. And all the way at the bottom, robotics. But before we talk about that, first, let's do data centers. This is the data center market in particular. And on the right-hand side of the slide, energy efficiency and also protection because of all of these new high voltage applications and making sure the right amount of power is going to the right chip. There's a lot of different power chips and sensors that go into these data center servers. And Allegro claims that the total opportunity per server rack there in the middle is significantly higher because of these new applications. So yeah, one of them would be memory chips, among other things. The actual power tree itself, when the different power is split, go to the different chips. So it could be the memory, the GPU, and so on. You're going to have these power chips and power sensors as well. This is where we really wanted to spend just a few moments here talking about these power and sensors. We've talked about it a number of times, but I think we need to hammer this home. If you think robotics, industrial automation of some sort, it could be like warehousing automation, it could be manufacturing automation with the cobots, the robotic arms, or if you think humanoid robots really are imminent, we're all going to have humanoid personal assistant walking around the office or walking around the house with us, you really want to have a basket of power and sensor chips in your portfolio. You really do. And I think this chart illustrates why, right? Take a look at the middle part of this slide from Allegro in particular. It's a big increase in possible content opportunity for these companies, a massive increase as these industrial applications, these physical AI, real world AI, if these markets do take off, these companies could be the biggest beneficiary. That's what I'm saying.
I'm just thinking, for instance, a cobot, every single movement that makes requires some type of motion sensor, correct? Mm-hmm. And so in all applications with all types of motion sensors in every action, every articulated movement.
Let's look at the next slide. This is what you're talking about.
This is exactly what I'm talking about.
We pulled this one from Monolithic Power because they also participate in these magnetic sensors as well, especially with Hall effect sensors and AMRs and GMR sensors. But exactly what you said, wherever you see a joint, a moving joint, there's at least two chips in that joint. You have a power chip governing power going to the motor, and then you have a sensor that helps the system understand the position of that joint and where it's at with whatever the robot is doing at that given time. And then, of course, not just the joints themselves, but also on the bottom with the microcontrol unit.
Let's talk about their guidance. We'll start with that.
Here's the guidance. Allegro has one of those weird fiscal years. Q3 fiscal year 2026 is basically the fourth quarter of calendar 2025. So their fiscal year will end in March 2026. There's the sales guidance. At the midpoint, $220 million of revenue, gross margin at 50%, and adjusted earnings per share, non-GAAP earnings per share of 14 cents. We'll put that in context for you here. The final bar in this chart is the calendar year Q4 estimate midpoint. And it's more of that slow and steady recovery as these companies make a comeback from the chip shortage in 2022, early 2023, when sales were unsustainably high. And so they're continuing to make progressive progress. It's good to see that the guidance is up sequentially because Q4 would typically be a seasonally down period for Allegro. A lot of these auto industrial and power companies we've been talking about have been reporting guidance to be revenue to be up in Q4. So bucking some of the historical trends where you would typically see some seasonality. And in fact, you can see that last year in this chart, you can see the December quarter, you can see the revenue was sequentially down from the September quarter. That's not supposed to be the case this year. Inventories are very low or have normalized for these companies and for their customers. And so we're expected to have a sequential increase where normally there would be a seasonal down period. there's the valuation. And remember, it's a cyclical business like all semiconductor businesses are. And as a result, it always looks expensive. At the beginning of a new growth cycle, it looks expensive because profitability was nil or very low in the trailing 12-month period. In fact, on a GAAP basis, they're still not profitable on a trailing 12-month basis. So we're still lapping some GAAP net losses on a free cash flow basis, 85x on a trailing 12-month basis, because free cash flow was very low in the last year. So that's a look at the valuation. Enterprise value to sales at about 6 to 7x on a trailing 12-month basis. It's about in line with what you would expect for a chip designer. We're at the beginning of a growth cycle. This is one that we have in our portfolio, in our basket. We're happy to have it. And after the recent sell-off, this looks interesting to us again. If you expect this new wave of growth to continue into calendar year 2026.